All right, welcome back, and this is going to be part two of the Sanyo Beta Machine model 4400. And I was able to pick up all of the mechanical things we needed for this at our local parts store, including, unbelievably, the complete VA07 idler assembly for the incredible low price of $9 on discount. So we're going to go ahead and get all these things changed out and do some other mechanical things to it, run through a series of tests, playback and record. We'll hook a source up to it, get a signal into it, and we're going to do a composite video test as well as trying to get a signal into the tuner. So give me a second to get set up for that, and we will come back and get started on this. Coming back in, and the first thing we're going to do is we're going to remove the old idler assembly. I don't see any need at all to replace this bottom plate right here. That's part of the new assembly that I bought, but I just don't see any need in doing that. We'll take a look at this guy. The tire is nice and glossed over. And back in the day, I never had the luxury of being able to replace the whole thing as a complete piece. These tires would have to be changed individually. And this portion right here, let's get that belt off, which I'm sure is in pretty bad shape. It's nice and stiff and looks like it could break in half if you play with it too much. And this should come right up. This is not looking that bad. Normally, if this was in real bad shape, this would all be cleaned up and possibly even re-grooved with an X-Acto knife, but this looks pretty good. So the one time I get the whole complete assembly, I get it for a machine that's not really in the original parts, are really not in that bad of shape. So get rid of that. And I believe there is another clip here, maybe. Let's see. Or does it just come up? I was thinking that's another clip there. No, it doesn't. It just comes right up. Okay. And let's have a look at this one. This one's not in too bad a shape. So it's a little glossy, but I've seen a lot worse. Let's get that tire off there. There it comes. Yep, you see the cuts in it now. The cracking. That tire is about ready to fall apart. And so you can see them in there now. All right. Very nice. We're going to hit this with a little bit of oil just to make sure it's good to go. Yeah, this bottom plate, just don't see a need to switch that out. I don't see anything being wrong with that unless there was some kind of potential that this was bent, but clearly it is not, so. And we're going to use a little bit of acetone and get that pulley cleaned up, the belt goes on. So that is pretty dirty, I would imagine. Yeah, that's not. It's not in great shape, that's for sure. Let's hit it a little bit more. think that's going to be okay. Looks like there's some material right on the outside of the pulley here, but I don't know. That's just some defect in the metal. Whatever it is, it isn't coming off with this, so I think we're okay. Take a little closer look at it. Yeah, it looks okay. I mean, it doesn't have anything gummy or gooey in it, so I'm going to say we're going to be all right there. I'll disassemble, wipe my hands off, and I'll disassemble this other one, and we'll get started on getting that one put back together. This one not using a C-clip, but using a split ring retaining clip. So I believe we're going to go with the C-clip and putting it back together. We can see the difference here. The tire is in very nice shape. Very clean. Does have a little bit of a sheen to it, but it feels good. So I think we're going to call that good. I'm going to pull the bottom two pieces off as a complete piece, maybe. Fighting just a little bit. There it goes. And drop the washer down in there, but I think I see it. Got it. Lucky me. Okay. Feels like that's moving very well, so now's a good time to put on the SCA 2.3 belt, which goes around the real motor and the pulley for the idler. Making sure that that's sitting square between the pulley and the real motor itself. It kind of should just kind of V-channel in there, if you know what I'm talking about. And then the last piece, extend that out, and it should just slip right down in there perfectly. instead of using the split ring clip, we'll use the C clip. Try not to send it flying across the room. There we go. Looks pretty good. All right, so I think the next step I want to do, we're going to remove both of the reels, oil underneath there. Last thing I want is that noise right there when it's in fast forward and rewind, so that will prevent that from happening. So give me a second. I'm going to fight with these clips to get those off, and we'll come back with oiling up the reels. All right, picking back up. Two things. First, I had to remove this again because I noticed that this piece right here was laying on my bench and it's just pressed into the top of this, but this is, keep in mind, this is brand new. It's never been used, but yet there was a split right in the very top of where this, you know, is fitted into that. And so that plastic, obviously, whether it's used or not, still ages the same way. And so what I did was mix up some epoxy and I epoxied the piece back in there. There's no real tension, you know, no real force on it. It's just used basically as a nudge to nudge it to the take-up reel or the supply reel or the take-up reel. So I think we're going to be okay there. And pretty much as predicted, as soon as I tried to pop the clip off of this reel, it went flying across my garage. So that would be the reason why I have these out, so I can get a replacement one. And now that I have that reel nice and oiled, and by the way, we got a nice little pulse reel sensor there just to keep things in time in case anything goes off the rails and the reel stops moving, it shuts down the machine. We'll pull this back, and now when we spin that, it's perfectly silent. Don't have any crazy noise, so I'll take our replacement piece here, which is clear versus the black one that was there before, and see if we can press it down in there. We'll use a pair of hemostats. Pop back off. What's going on? There we go. Got that on there nice and secure. The ones from the factory are on there very, very tight. And so it's kind of a pain to get them off. But and that just spins forever now that it's got a nice layer of oil on the spindle. So let me see what kind of luck I have trying to remove this one. And again, these are on there so tightly. And you're in that tight little space, so it's not like you can stick your fingers in there to assist you with it. You gotta kind of use two tools to dig it out with. Okay. A little better that time. Got it off there. Didn't go flying. So set that off to the side. That one doesn't sound too bad. Let's see. Let me guess. There is something else holding that in the way. There we go. Back tension band. This right here is kind of slotted for this portion of the reel. And we are going to remove that so we can oil there too. You can see something down in there. I don't know. You know, it doesn't look like there's anything covering any of the other parts, so not sure if that was something that was there from the factory or what. Not sure if I brushed up against that, but we're going to wipe it off just in case. Back tension band still in pretty good shape. Let's drop this back on. There we go. And I probably just dumped that C-clip into the machine. There was a washer, a little split ring washer there. No, it's still on there, I think. Let's see. Yeah, it is still there. I guess we're good there. Care of that. And now we'll just use the original one that was on there. Try not to send it flying. I always pull up on the reel just to make sure that it's not some kind of illusion that I got it clicked into place. But we seem to be real good right there. So takes care of that. We'll move on to the belt in the rear here, which should be an easy one to get to. Maybe even possibly with the hemostats. It comes right out. You can see it's been sitting in that position so long, it's kind of taken the shape of the last position it had. Let's see if we can get this guy down in there, get it on the pulley, and then over this. This you got to be a little careful with just to make sure that you didn't get any excessive grease or anything on the belt. It looks good, so I think we're going to call that okay. I'll usually always spin it around to make sure it's seated correctly. It's probably a good argument that, you know, if you're really, you know, going full bore, you would lubricate this rotating ring that spools out the tape as it's being loaded up, but we are absolutely not going to do that. That is moving freely. So, all right, let me look into this pressure roller thing and see if we can easily remove it, and if so, we'll do that, and we will clean up our pressure roller a little bit. All right, picking back up, I was able to get the whole arm off, and once I got that off, then I was able to get the little retainer that holds the pressure roller on. Got it cleaned up. Couldn't be happier with the way this turned out. Very nice glaze came off real easy. Got it back to the point to where it looks really, really good. Feels good. Got a good bite to it. So I think we're going to be okay there. So I think the next step is I'm going to go ahead and the epoxy is all set up on this. Get this back together. Get our loading cage in. And then we can just do some preliminary mechanical checks, fast forward and rewind, make sure all that's good. And then from that point, I think the next step would be maybe to start assembling it, putting it all back together, and maybe take a look at the caps and the power supply, see how those are going or how those have aged, and then start the testing process. So give me a minute for that, and we'll come back. All right, coming back, picking back up on the machine after about a day and a half. Also took care of a few housekeeping issues outside of the video. One of the biggest ones, got the machine kind of blown out, wiped down, everything looking a lot less dusty and a little bit more appealing. It's the little things that do mean a lot. The buttons, these particular buttons are the ones that have a grooved surface. Getting all the nasty out of those grooves made a big, big difference in the appearance of the unit. The clock has been set for a couple of days and it is right on the money. Went through the power supply with my ESR meter. Didn't come up with anything that was even remotely bad other than one capacitor, which was totally bad. And that is going to be this 47 mic at 35 volt. Went ahead and changed that out with 100 mic at 35 volt because that's what I had handy. Other than that, a couple of things over here. When I was doing the mechanism work, I noticed that there was some kind of, what appeared to be some kind of liquid kind of laying down in the bottom right there. And I now know that that came out of this. This is the damping mechanism for the door as it pops open. And that goo that you see down there is the damping fluid from that. So, not gonna mess with that. I don't have any damping fluid, so we'll leave that as is. But that is definitely the reason why we get such a nice tight pop. Very loud and abrasive as it's popping back out of there. Got the center post from the idler now firmly epoxied in place. No issues there. Also, I believe in the first part of the video, I mentioned this switch as being the potential switch for tape in. That is not. That is the record tab switch. The reason that I know that is because when I tried to drop it into record, it was intermittent. Sometimes it would let me and sometimes not. And I recall running into that problem once. And yes, switch a little bit dirty there. So clean that up and all that is good. Did check some of the capacitors on the bottom video board. And aside from a few 1 mic at 50s or 2.2 at 50, I believe, or maybe it was a 4.7 at 50, all the other higher value capacitors, totally fine. The lower value capacitors, yes, if you want to be picky about it, they certainly could be changed out, but none of them were absolute zero bad. They were just low. So we're going to leave that alone and not mess with any of that. Cleaned up the tape path, everything good there. And also, got ourselves a old school CRT. I have one that I keep in my garage in a plastic bag and pulled it out so we could use it to test this with. The LCD monitor I keep on my bench. The only reason I have that monitor is just simply because of the fact that it has VGA, HDMI, and composite video. Having two separate monitors, a CRT and an LCD. But this machine, we definitely want to use this monitor to check out. And the way this is actually going is I have a PACE analog cable box. There's a big sprawl of coax running across my garage, firing into this guy, comes out of this box and goes into the beta machine, out of the beta machine and into the TV, and of course the TV resides on channel 3. And As far as the machine is concerned, like I said, we do have these guys right here as far as the preset tuning. And what we can do is try to get everything in the shot, but I don't think we'll be able to. So what we're gonna do is tune off. And we're gonna get nothing but snow, but if I put it back to channel 3, our picture comes back there. And as far as these little wheels are concerned, if you check this out, this is kind of the way that you tune that in. And I think in the beginning I told you that there's a button right here, a hidden switch, that when you close the door, if the door was present, it would press against that switch. And that is our AFT. And if I take something and activate that switch, the picture will straighten right up. Maybe. Let's try that again. So if you happen to have the station off-tuned a little bit, as soon as you press that in, it will tune it in for you, give you that fine tuning. So we'll put that back the way it was. This only gives us an indication that the low band is working. As far as the UHF band and the VHF high band, that will have to remain a mystery because I didn't go and get my friend's generator, but that's not something that you would use in normal setup anyway. If you're gonna do any recording with this, most likely you're gonna want a channel 3 input, or you're gonna want a direct composite video input. So I've already done some recording with it, but I didn't have this monitor set up when I did it, so we're gonna go ahead and get this set up, or get a tape put in it and do a little recording with it and see what our picture quality looks like. So give me a minute to get set up for that and we'll come back and get that going. All right, picking back up, and hopefully Bissell doesn't mind if we use their infomercial as some test record material. And we'll start off, we'll do beta 2 first, the faster of the two speeds. Tape is in place, and we're gonna set it up to do a timer record, but before we do that, let's shift it over to the counter and reset. And this is a 2-button record. And we'll go to about 15, and then we'll back it up and see what we got. It looked pretty decent on the LCD, but interested in seeing what it looks like on this. And unfortunately, I just don't know how the phone image sensor and the phone will, you know, not sure how that will interpret this old school technology. Usually it doesn't do a good job interpreting that, but we should be okay. Okay, let's back that up. Now that that idler assembly has been replaced, the fast forward and rewind is very swift. All right, so here we go. Let's see what we get. Yeah, I don't know how the phone interprets it, but it's a very watchable picture, very watchable. Pretty much everything you remember about recording on videotape, the text is, I don't want to say blurry, but not as crisp as watching it live. But for the most part, the audio is very good, and the picture is absolutely watchable. Even by today's standards, it's not something that we would want to trade high definition for, but it is definitely watchable. And the audio is spot on, so let's do this. Let's turn the volume down on this. And the way that the timer record on this works, and I had to refamiliarize myself with it, is you get either your choice between 3 days, three different events, or the E, which I'm going to assume is for every day. And so we're going to start off here. Our time is 1:18, so let's see. Where are we at? Record start. Let's go to PM. Let's go to 1:20. And then the stop time, we'll make that 121. And this time we'll do beta 3. And here you have to turn the machine, shift the machine from off to timer. And when you do that, of course, since the RF modulator is in the VCR position, it just immediately gives you snow. So let's give that a second and see what happens here. Obviously an incredible advancement back in the day to be able to record something when you're not home and watch it later. I mean, we all have DVRs now that we totally take for granted, but, and it did, kicks on beautifully. And of course our picture is restored. So, and if everything goes as planned, it should shut off at 121 and then we'll back it up and have a look at it. I don't have any reason to believe that the UHF band or the VHF high band in this tuner has got anything wrong with it. I'm sure it would work just fine, but again, there's no analog TV anymore, or at least not in my area, so wouldn't be anything that would be useful. So let's see what we got here. There it goes. Shuts off when we will turn on. And I don't think we did get a counter, but I'm not sure how accurate that is. So we'll just go maybe to 28, 24. Let's see what we got. There's our beta 3.
And then as the smartwatch is pulled back, look at that dirty water getting
and again,
sucked into the dirty
not quite
water.
Sure how the phone is interpreting it, probably not very well, but it is a very watchable picture. Definitely a difference in quality between beta 2 and beta 3, but this is still a very watchable picture on this size TV anyway. You blow this up to about 27, 32 inches and it would be a big difference, but for the most part, this is a very watchable picture. So, the age of the machine, what we say from the sticker on the front of it, 84, 85, quite a few years old, a few decades old, and still doing its thing. And so, basically just like an old car, just a mechanical maintenance required, but for the most part, the electrical systems and so forth have kind of remained intact with no trouble. So I think from this point, I'm going to go ahead and get the top lid back on it, and we will do a final play test and put this to bed. All right, as we wrap this one up, if you hang around for both parts, thanks very much for doing so. I know these video projects aren't as popular as the audio ones are, but for me, I still have a fondness for these old machines, and any technician from back in my time that worked on these will tell you these were excellent money makers. Not very many people that owned one of these machines back in the day, and even many years afterwards, would say no to the repair. They would always spend the money and get it fixed because they knew how much it cost when they originally bought it. So our final play test, I only ever had one commercial made tape for beta at my shop, and it was the Synchronicity concert by the Police. So not sure how much of this we could get away with showing on video, but let's go ahead and let's catch a little bit on the way out here.